Galatians chapter 1. Last week, we introduced Galatians. We didn't actually dive into it as we will. We kind of introduced and then we kind of gave an overview of the epistle to the Galatians written by Paul. Galatia is a region. It would be modern-day Turkey if you were to look at a map now. It was inhabited, if you remember, we probably have some ties to this area in a group this size, given the fact that many of us would have European ancestry. The Galatians were immigrants from the Celtic and the Franks, or the French, who went over from Europe over to the area there of Turkey that came to be known as Galatia. Paul had gone through Galatia on his first and his second missionary journeys, and he had established many churches to which he now writes. So that's kind of how it's working out. The epistle was written in 49 or 50 AD, as best we can tell, following the first church council in Jerusalem, because he writes about the first church council, which we read about in Acts 15, he writes about it in Galatians. And scholars have dated that council to about 48 AD. So, 49 or 50 AD, written by Paul to the Galatians. And we start off in verse 1, and we're gonna dive in here, and there's a lot more than you would think, even in these couple of verses that we'll look at tonight. Verse 1 says, Paul, an apostle, not of men, neither by men, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead. Now, in this day, it was common, when we write a letter, we usually write, dear so-and-so, and then down at the bottom, we say love, or sincerely, or however you close your letter, and then we write our name. In this culture, they would usually sign their name at the top. They would begin with an introduction that said who was writing, which, if you're honest or you're anything like me, when I open a letter, the first thing I do is look to see who wrote it anyway. So they just saved you the effort and they would write it at the top, typically. So he's signing in with his name rather than signing off with it at the end, which sometimes they did as well. His name is Paul, which means, it means little, it means small, diminutive. I think it's interesting. If you go, it's not in the biblical record, but if you're interested in it, and you go look at church history, and you find out kind of what we can find out about the apostles, sometimes even their physical description is given. Paul, in early writings of early church history, he was given the nickname, the man of three cubits. A cubit being about 18 inches, meaning, if that's the case, Paul would have stood 4'6". So, not a tall man by any stretch of the imagination. You also find, if you look, you'll find that they said he was bald and he was bow-legged. So, we don't know any of that from biblical history, but we do have it from church history, and it's from multiple sources. So, you know, where there's smoke, there's usually some fire. Where there's a lot of sources kind of giving the same information, usually there's some truth to it. Most would say that Paul was a very short man. In our text, Paul immediately gives his credentials. He starts in by saying, here's who I am, and here's why I'm talking. Here's why you should hear what I have to say. This is what enables him to speak to the Galatians, as he will in the coming verses. He's going to get a little bit rough with the Galatian believers. He's going to talk to them. He's going to cut very, very straight. Sometimes it's going to cut across the grain. And so Paul, in the very first, few strokes of his pen, he says, here's who I am, you know me, and here's why you should hear what I have to say, giving his credentials. Paul, an apostle, the Greek word apostolos, a delegate, an ambassador, or he that is sent. That's what it means. When we say an apostle, that's what it means. One who is sent, a delegate, an ambassador. If you look back in the Gospels, Jesus selected 12 to accompany him during his earthly ministry. In Mark chapter 3, verse 14, we read, "And he ordained 12, that they should be with him, and that he might send them forth to preach." When you see there the word send, that is the word apostolos. Okay? It's the verb of apostle. He was going to send them forth. Luke chapter 6, verse 13, "And when it was day, he called unto him his disciples, and of them he chose 12, whom also he named apostles." An apostle, a sent one, a delegate, an ambassador. So there are 12 original apostles. I'm not going to ask you to, but how many of you think, if you had to, you could name the 12 apostles? How many of you would have to start singing under your breath if you were going to do so? Okay, so there is a song that goes with the 12 apostles. Some of them we know. You could probably easily name 6 or 7 of them. And then there's some of the ones that we forget about. There's Thaddeus and Bartholomew. We don't know a whole lot about them. But 12 original apostles. Why did they become 11 right after the crucifixion? Judas hung himself, okay? So what did they do? Well, if you look in Acts chapter 1, verse 26, the apostles amongst themselves, the 11, they said, "We need to find someone else to be an apostle." So they gathered together and they cast lots, and the lot fell to Matthias. The purpose of the office of the apostle was to lay the foundation of the early church upon the teachings of Christ. Why were the 11 apostles and then the 12, why were they uniquely equipped to lay a foundation on the teachings of Christ? They were with him. For 3.5 years, they walked with him. What did Peter do when he had a question about one of Christ's teachings? He walked over to him and he said, "What did you mean?" Okay? So they had a relationship, they had a dynamic and living relationship with Jesus where they could ask questions and be given answers. Now, did they get everything that they were told? If you picked up anything in our study in Luke, you realize that a lot of times Jesus would say something and just right over their heads. But all of that teaching didn't just go in one ear and out the other. We know that after his resurrection, Jesus sat down with the disciples, the apostles, and he opened their understanding. And everything that had been said to them over the past 3.5 years kind of came to life. The apostles were given divine power to heal the sick as a sign of the validity of their teaching. We would call it a sign gift. Okay? Their ability to heal. It was not used as a circus trick. It was used to validate their message. Why else would you listen to a fisherman and his brother from Galilee who were telling you what you've believed up to this point has been fulfilled, the Messiah has come? Why would you believe them? Well, you wouldn't unless that fisherman from Galilee could walk up to a lame man and tell him, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, rise up and walk." That validated their ministry. So they had divine power to heal. All of the apostles were visual witnesses of the resurrected Lord. Acts chapter 1, verse 22, you find when they were talking about selecting Matthias that they used this as one of the qualifications. They need to have seen Jesus, not just before he died, but after he died and when he had risen from the dead. You say, well, that kind of writes Paul off a little bit, doesn't it? No, it doesn't, because the Apostle Paul was an eyewitness to the risen Christ. He says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 5, this is Paul laying out what happened after the resurrection. He says, "And that he, Jesus, was seen of Cephas, then of the 12. After that, he was seen of about 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present. But some are fallen asleep. After that, he was seen of James, then of all the apostles, and last of all, he was seen of me also, as one born out of due time." Paul, the writer of 1 Corinthians, saying, I saw him too. I've seen the risen Christ. When did the risen Christ appear to Paul?
On the road to Damascus.
What was Paul doing on the road to Damascus? He was on his way to cast Christians into prison. And God shone down a bright light, knocked him off his horse, and said, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? He saw the risen Christ. Now, following the replacement of Judas Iscariot by Matthias, we have no biblical record of a continuing office of the apostle. This was not something where Peter found a successor and passed on the apostolic office to him. God still sends messages by all believers, those who have the gospel. God tells us all to go forth with it. But the last to hold the office of the apostle was John. John died following his writing of the Revelation, likely sometime after 98 AD. Sometimes today you will hear someone, you will see someone, perhaps a person who claims to be a pastor or a minister, and they will have apostle on their title. That's a bit presumptuous. Okay, so the office of the apostle, we have no biblical reason to say that it passed on after the original apostles had passed off of the scene. When Peter died, he didn't appoint a successor to his apostleship. When Paul died, he didn't appoint a successor to his apostleship. He passed off the scene, and God gave evangelists and pastors and teachers, and God gave all of these gifts to the churches, but the office of the apostle as an office has since passed off of the scene. When somebody includes apostolic in their doctrine and they say, I am an apostolic successor to one of the apostles, there's usually good reason for you to take a deeper look at what else they're teaching, because usually that's a sign of some bad doctrine. So Paul's selection as an apostle was different than all of the others, but it was no less valid. Paul, here, he starts out, Paul, an apostle. He wasn't one of the original 12. He wasn't the one who was chosen by the 11 to replace Judas, but he's no less an apostle because, look at the second part of verse 1, because he was chosen not of men, neither by men, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead. Some people in this day challenged Paul's apostleship because it was different than the others. How he became an apostle wasn't the same as how Peter became an apostle. Jesus chose the 12 as they stood physically before him, and he called them to be apostles. Matthias, in Acts 1:26, chosen by the 11, and his name selected by the casting of lots. And if you think about it, Saul of Tarsus, as he was then known, would have been the last man on earth that the other apostles would have looked to add as one of their number. If you were looking for an apostle, hey, let's pick the guy who's arresting us and putting us to death. You wouldn't look for him. That's what Paul, or Saul, as he was then, he was, according to 1 Timothy 1:3, he was a blasphemer and a persecutor, and injurious to the church. Paul was chosen, one of the least likelies. He was chosen by Jesus, no less than the other 11, only at a different time and under different circumstances. Paul is going to explain more about his selection and his preparation a little bit later. If you look ahead, we won't get there tonight. In chapter 1, verse 12 and following, you see a little bit about how he was chosen and then how he received his teachings of Christ. Where did Paul learn about Judaism? Well, he learned in Jerusalem under the finest teachers. He says in one of the epistles, the other epistles, that he sat at the feet of Gamaliel. That's the equivalent of being able to say that you have a Harvard law degree if you're going into law. Okay? Paul had been taught by the very best of the best when it came to Judaism. Who taught him about Christianity? Well, if you look ahead, you'll see in chapter 1, verse 12, he was taught by Jesus himself for a period of time. Yes, sir?
Wasn't he Roman?
The Apostle Paul, yes.
Why would he be taught the Jewish?
He was Jewish by birth, Roman by citizenship. Okay. Because Tarsus was a city, it was a Roman city, and those who were born in Tarsus were Roman citizens. Yeah? So, citizen of Rome, but Jewish by nationality. As Paul goes through here and he's sharing about his apostleship and how he came to be an apostle, it's interesting. He kind of takes an opportunity to mention one of his favorite topics briefly. He says that he was chosen by Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead. Paul never really got over the resurrection. All through his ministry, he never got over the resurrection. It wasn't something that he heard about and thought, oh, that's nice. Paul celebrated the resurrection more than when the resurrection Sunday came around. Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, Paul says, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death. The Apostle Paul would take and he would trace all of the effectiveness that he had in ministry to the fact that he served a risen Savior. If you read, you find in Romans chapter 6 that in Christ we have life because he's alive. Paul's claim to the office of apostle was not from a man or from a group of men, but from the living Christ, who changed him from Saul of Tarsus to Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles. Again, one of those least likely to happen. No one would have looked at Saul of Tarsus and said, this is going to be a man who shakes the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. He wasn't chosen by men because man didn't see his potential, but God did. God saw in this great persecutor of the church one of his most effective evangelists and missionaries. And so he was chosen, not by man, not by a group of men, but by Jesus Christ himself and God the Father. Verse 2, he says, and what? Well, he's giving his credentials. Who selected him? Well, God. And then he says, and all the brethren which are with me unto the churches of Galatia. Paul's appointment as an apostle by Jesus Christ was not his only claim. He was also accepted by the brethren of the church. You say, big deal. Who cares if he was accepted by the brethren of the church? Well, hold on. I'll build a case for you here in just a moment. Paul was accepted. Did it take some time? Yeah, and it took a little bit of help. It took some help by Barnabas. We talked about this briefly last week. When Paul came and he comes to Jerusalem, he says, I'm a Christian now. What did they think? Yeah, right. Yeah, no, this is some sort of a trap. And they said, you're not coming in. And it took Barnabas, whose name means the son of consolation. Barnabas came alongside Saul of Tarsus, or Paul, and he talked with him and found out who he was. And eventually, Barnabas helped Paul come into the church. He helped Paul to be accepted by the other brethren. But this, when Paul is penning this epistle to the Galatians, he's well into ministry. He is much accepted by the brethren, he says here in verse 2, which are with me. Does it matter what the church says? It does. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15, Paul, again, speaking to Timothy, says, but if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. Churches have a large portion in being preservers of truth. In Matthew chapter 18, when you think Matthew 18, usually if you're thinking of that chapter content, you think that's the passage on church discipline. And you're right. Jesus speaking in the context of a church, the word church being ecclesia, a called out assembly, Jesus is speaking in the context of a called-out assembly of believers, and he says in Matthew 18:19, "Again, I say unto you, that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them." Does it matter when a church agrees on truth? There's validation in that. There's validation for Paul to be able to say to the Galatians, "I've been chosen not by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead. And I've been, my apostleship has been acknowledged by the church." That's important. When I was ordained into ministry, I was ordained at the church where my father was the pastor at the time, and my dad had a little bit of an issue with the idea of a church ordaining someone. Does a church ordain someone to the gospel ministry?
Church of Christ.
The Church of Christ. Who actually ordains someone to ministry? Who ordains someone to the office of a pastor? Well, God does. What part does the church play in that? Well, the church acknowledges that call. The church acknowledges, yes, the hand of God is on this person. We would agree they have that gifting. They're going forth. That's the point. That's what Paul is saying. So does this passage here in Matthew 18, verse 19 and following, and 1 Timothy 3:15, where it says that the church is the pillar and ground of the truth, does that mean that two or three of us can get together and decide that we want to set aside the preaching of God's word, we want to have a rock concert at church instead? Does that make it true? Is that what this means? That the church, as long as we agree, it is God's truth. Is that what the Bible is teaching right here? No, it's not. It's not teaching that at all. Speaking of Jesus, in Colossians 1:18, the Apostle Paul said, "And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence." Who is the head of the church? Well, the pastor. No. Who's the head of the church? Well, the congregation, right? Who's the head of the church? Jesus Christ. And what if the pastor doesn't agree with Jesus Christ?
And you don't have it either.
It's a problem. Yeah? What if the congregation doesn't agree with Jesus Christ? We still go with Christ. Jesus is the head of the church. And Jesus has chosen to reveal himself in the pages of his word. Jesus has chosen. This is how he communicates with us. He's chosen also. He leads us by his Holy Spirit. So if a church makes a decision to walk away from the revealed word and will of God, it's not right just because the church does it. Okay? It's not that, well, whatever, it's not democracy rules and establishes truth. That's a prescription for disaster. But there is significance to a body of spirit-filled and spirit-led believers coming to the same conclusion on something. To a body of believers who says, "I feel like God would have us to do this." And more come alongside, they say, "You know what? I do think that's God's will. Let's look in his word. Let's find out what he says. Yeah, that looks like something that God is leading us toward." Does it matter when a church does that? Absolutely it does. When a church gathers together around God's word, which is the truth, John 17:17, and they say, "We're looking for God's guidance. Can God lead all of us in the same direction as a body?" Absolutely. Will the Holy Spirit lead us in two opposite directions? No. No. So there's something to it when the Apostle Paul says, "Look, I haven't been chosen by man or by men. I've been chosen by God, but I've been acknowledged by the brethren." The brethren have said, they've acknowledged what God has ordained. That is definitely of note. Paul, an apostle, chosen by the resurrected Christ, not by men, though his apostleship was recognized by the church, which is made up of men and women who have trusted him. He's writing unto the churches of Galatia. So he's not writing to Independent Bible Church of Galatia. He's writing to the churches. He's writing to a group of churches. Likely, if we look in Acts, we find some of the names of the towns in Galatia where there were churches. Iconium and Derbe and Lystra and Antioch of Pisidia. So he's writing to probably at least these and perhaps others. Verse number 3, we find grace and peace. Grace be to you and peace from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ. In every single one of his New Testament writings, the Apostle Paul has words similar to this, where he says, grace and peace be unto you. It's important. Grace, the Greek word charis, generosity unmotivated by the worthiness of the recipient. Unmerited favor is what some have called grace. God's undeserved, unmerited favor bestowed upon ungodly sinners. How important is grace? Ephesians 2:8, for by grace are ye saved through faith. How important is grace? It's pivotal. You don't get to heaven without the grace of God. It's essential to salvation. How about peace? Peace, the Greek word Irene, which I looked. The name Irene is a transliteration of the Greek. It means peace. Peace, rest, quietness, harmony, accord. Peace is the natural result of receiving the grace of God in our lives. These two go hand in hand. Grace and peace be unto you. You can't have peace without grace. And if you have grace, you'll have peace. Grace, one commentator said, is positional. Peace is practical. Grace affects my standing before God. Peace affects my comfort, my ability to be calm. We've talked a lot about peace on Sunday mornings in Sunday school. Grace is positional, peace is practical, and together they flow from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ. We mentioned briefly last week that one of the reasons for Paul's writings of this epistle was to combat the heresy of a group called the Judaizers. Do you remember this? The Judaizers. Do you hear a root in there in Judaizers? It's Judaism. Okay? The Judaizers, their whole thing was they tried to take the law of Moses and marry it with the grace of God. And it doesn't work. Their idea, if you want to truly be saved, then you have to keep the law of Moses. That doesn't work. If that was the case, no one would be saved because no man can keep the law. And so, if you think about it, the Judaizers preach this heretical doctrine, and this false heretical doctrine robbed those who believed in it of both grace and peace. If you believe that in order to get to heaven, you have to keep the law, then the Bible tells us in Romans 11:6, it says, and if by grace, speaking of salvation, then it is no more works. Otherwise, grace is no more grace. But if it be of works, then it is no more grace. Otherwise, work is no more work. When you add works to grace, it nullifies the grace. So, if you believe in the message that Paul is writing to combat, you don't have grace because you're adding the works of the law to the works of Christ and the grace that he offers it. Adding works to grace nullifies it, but following a graceless behavior reliant on religion is anything but peaceful. If you're dependent upon your works for salvation, When can you confidently say that you've done enough? Never. There is no assurance. When somebody says, well, I think I've been good enough to get to heaven, does that sound like peace? That's not peace. That's turmoil. There's never a point you say, well, I think my good deeds outweigh my bad deeds. What if they don't? There's no peace there. If you're operating without grace, you won't have peace. And so Paul greets the believers in Galatia with the grace and peace that is only available through Jesus Christ. Coming to verse 4, who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil world according to the will of God and of our Father. Verse 4 is describing the givers of grace and peace. Capital G, givers. It's from God the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. God the Father sent Jesus to deliver us from this present evil world. Mankind was without grace, without peace, undone and bound for eternity in the lake of fire. But God, those are two great words, but God loved man, whom he had created, and sent his only begotten Son to redeem man and to restore fellowship between Creator and his creation. That's why Jesus came. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24, speaking of what Christ did, it says, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye are healed. What did Jesus do for you? Well, he came and he took your sin. He took the penalty of sin. Sin, the wages of sin is death, and he died for you. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ. This that we read about in verse 4, who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil world according to the will of God our Father. Jesus Christ provides the only way, the only means of salvation through him. Jesus died, though, not only to save us from our sins, but so that he could deliver us, according to verse 4, from this present evil world. That means what about eternal life? It doesn't start when you close your eyes in death. When does eternal life start? The moment you trust Christ, when you're born again to life. Jesus died not just to save us from our sins, though that is pivotal. He also died to save us from this present evil world. Deliver, the word there, that he might deliver us. That word means to rescue, to release, to pluck out. Jesus died to one day remove you from this world, but until he chooses to remove you, he'll keep you. Jesus' death on the cross means more to a believer than deliverance from hell, but deliverance from the world's twisted and evil system. That's what the word world means. Perhaps you see it translated as age. It could also be translated system. He died to deliver you, to pluck you out of this evil age, this evil system in which we find ourselves. In John 17, Jesus prays for his followers. Some have called John 17 the real Lord's Prayer. It's one of the most powerful chapters in all of the New Testament. John 17, verse 14, Jesus is praying. He says, I have given them thy word. He's talking to the Father. And the world hath hated them, because they're not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I pray not that thou shouldst keep them, that thou shouldst take them out of the world, but that thou shouldst keep them from the evil. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Jesus didn't pray for our removal. What did he pray for? Our keeping. Lord, don't take them out. Father, don't take them out. Rather, keep them. Surround them. Protect them. Ephesians 2, verse 4 tells us, but God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Jesus died on the cross, and according to Romans chapter 6, when Jesus died, I died with him. His death is my death. His resurrection is my resurrection. His life is my life. Where is Jesus now? He's at the right hand of the Father. And where am I, positionally speaking? I'm in Christ, which means I too, according to Ephesians 2:6, am seated together with him in heavenly places. God's not going to remove us from this world the moment we trust him, but he will keep us in this place. Jesus' sacrificial death to purchase the redemption of man and to restore man to the fellowship for which he was intended is certainly, verse 4, according to the will of God and of our Father. And then Paul closes his introduction in verse 5 with his reason for writing. He says, "To whom be glory forever and ever. Amen." He's speaking of God, our Father, to whom be glory, God. In the very next verse, verse 6, if you look at it, Paul's going to dive straight in to the problems that the church in Galatia is facing. He's going to light into the Judaizers and their heresy that they're spreading. Paul is jealously guarding the glory that's due only to God. And the legalism of the Judaizers, those people who say, you have to trust Jesus and keep the law, that robs God of his glory. Because if, as the Judaizers taught, heaven is earned through the keeping of the law, then at least some of the glory should go to me if I make it to heaven, right? If I earned my way there. If I had to trust Christ and keep the law, and I kept the law enough to make it into heaven, when I got there, I could look back and say, I did all right. I did pretty good. But the Judaizers were wrong. You could give me verses tonight that say as much. The Judaizers are wrong. Heaven is going to be filled with people who experience the grace and peace of God through the gift of his Son. For by grace are ye saved through faith. And it's not of yourselves. Why? Why is it not of works? Lest any man should boast. When I stand in heaven, and you stand there with me, all of the glory for our being there goes to Jesus Christ. Didn't I do anything? Well, I provided the sin that made a Savior necessary. Other than that, it's God. I don't get any of the glory because I didn't keep the law to get there. That's what the Apostle Paul says, "To whom be glory forever and ever. Amen," or so be it, the meaning of the word. Tonight we've seen Paul's office. He's an apostle, chosen and sent by God, recognized by the church. And Paul exalts and glorifies God for making salvation by grace alone and offering his peace to whosoever will. Who comes. That's the basis. Why is Paul going to speak as he does in the verses to come? Well, because he has the right, because he's been ordained by Jesus Christ himself to the office of the apostle. And he's jealous for the glory of God. And the Judaizers, the false doctrine of work salvation, robs God of his glory and gives it to man. And the Bible tells us that his glory he will share with no man. So that's what the Apostle Paul is doing. Any thoughts, questions, or comments that you have here on these first five verses of Galatians 1? Just the introduction. Next week we start into, in verse 6 he says, "I marvel that you're so soon removed from him that called you unto the grace of Christ unto another gospel. What's the, let me say it this way. Who's teaching the other gospel? The Judaizers. The people who say, you have to have Jesus and you have to keep the law. Law and grace don't go together. When you add the law to grace, it makes grace of none effect. And it fades away. Praise the Lord for what we have in His Word. Let's bow for a word of prayer here this evening. Our Father in heaven, we thank You for the writings that You've given to us, Lord, that You inspired, and then that You preserved in Your Word. I pray, Lord, that You would help us to have a deeper and a greater understanding of Your Word as we go through this book of Galatians. Lord, the Judaizers are not someone who we deal with in their original form, but Lord, we know that there are many people who we see on a regular basis who are trying to earn their way into heaven. Lord, I pray that You would enable us as we go through this epistle. Lord, I pray that You would enable us and equip us to share the gospel afresh and anew, to show people the way of grace and peace that You give us through Your Son, Jesus Christ. I pray that You'd be with us now as we go our separate ways. I pray that You'd bring us back safely at the next appointed time. And we pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen.